Section 5, we are discussing on orthopedic problems in upper limb. The shoulder joint. The shoulder joint consists of glenohumeral joint, scapulothoracic joint, acromioclavicular joint, and sternoclavicular joint. 17 muscles insert into scapula, and scapula is tilted 7 degrees medially in the coronal plane. Glenoid is retroverted by about 7 degrees to the body of the scapula. Humeral head is retroverted by about 30 to 40 degrees. Proximal humerus neck shaft angle is about 130 to 140 degrees. There is a significant mismatch between the articular surface of the humerus and the scapula. Stabilizers of the shoulder joint are mainly ligaments and muscles. Static stabilizers are number 1, labrum, number 2, capsule, number 3, ligaments, mainly coracohumeral ligament and glenohumeral ligament. Rotator interval is occupied by coracohumeral ligament. Inferior glenohumeral ligament complex is the most important static stabilizer. Dynamic stabilizers are rotator cuff and long head of biceps. Rotator cuff muscles are subscapularis, supplied by nerve to subscapula, supraspinatus, supplied by suprascapular nerve, infraspinatus, supplied by suprascapular nerve, and teres minor, which is supplied by axillary nerve. Posteriorly, interval between teres minor and infraspinatus is safe interval to enter the joint. Glenohumeral to scapular movement ratio generally is 2 degrees to 1 degree, that is 2:1. Acromioclavicular joint is a diarthroid joint with fibrocartilaginous disc. Stability of this joint is maintained by acromioclavicular capsular ligament and coracoclavicular ligament, which has two parts, conoid and trapezoid. Quadrangular space is bounded by subscapularis, teres major, long head of triceps, and humerus. Axillary nerve and humeral circumflex artery run through quadrangular space. Radial nerve runs through the triangular space, which is bounded by teres major, long head of triceps, and humerus. Brachial plexus has roots, trunks, divisions, and three chords. Branches of each of these sections are remembered as 310 and 355, otherwise 310 and 355. That means three branches from roots, one from trunk, and none for divisions, three branches from lateral cord, five branches from posterior cord, and five branches from medial cord. Three branches from the roots are long thoracic nerve, dorsal scapular nerve, and subclavian nerve. One branch from the trunk is suprascapular nerve. Three branches from the lateral cord are musculocutaneous nerve, lateral pectoral nerve, and lateral head of median nerve. Easier way to remember this one is musculocutaneous nerve is the most important branch of the lateral cord, and rest of the two start from the word lateral. Five branches from the medial cord are ulnar nerve, medial pectoral nerve, medial cutaneous nerve of the arm, medial cutaneous nerve of forearm, and medial head of median nerve. Easier way to remember this is ulnar nerve is the most important branch of medial cord, and rest of the branches start from the word medial. Five branches of the posterior cord are upper subscapular nerve, lower subscapular nerve, thoracodorsal nerves, axillary nerve, and radial nerve. Mnemonic for this one is 2-star, that is 2 subscapular nerves, thoracodorsal nerve, axillary nerve, and radial nerve. Shoulder joint approaches. Approaches are number 1, anterior deltopectoral approach, number 2, deltoid split approach or supero-anterior approach. Some people call it as lateral approach. This approach is most often used for rotator cuff surgery, and incision should not exceed more than 5 cm from the attachment of the deltoid muscle to avoid axillary nerve injury. Number three, posterior approach can be either muscle split through the infraspinatus muscle or interval between the infraspinatus and teres minor muscles. Deltoid may need to be stripped from the spine of the scapula for better exposure during posterior approach. Number four, arthroscopic portals to the shoulder joint. Posterior portal at the posterior soft spot, approximately 2 cm distal and 1 cm medial to the posterolateral corner of the acromion. Anterior portal is usually done using inside-out technique lateral to the coracoid process. And lateral approaches to approach the subacromial region can be 1 or 2, usually about 3 cm from the acromion. Number 4, acromioclavicular joint portals are direct portals. Anterior one, 1 cm to the anterior edge of the AC joint, and posterior one is 1 cm posterior to the posterior edge of the AC joint. Pathologies related to the shoulder joint are, number 1, inflammatory changes in the subacromial bursa and rotator cuff. Number 2, primary involvement of the rotator cuff. Number 3, disorders of the long head of biceps. Number 4, supraspinatus outlet problems causing subacromial impingement. Bigliani classified acromion according to its morphology into three groups. Type 1 is flat acromion, type 2 is curved acromion, and type 3 is prominent or hooked acromion. Number 5, non-outlet source of impingement due to greater tuberosity, malalignment, severe acromioclavicular separation, trapezius paralysis, and surgical neck malunion. Near stages of impingement in shoulders are stage 1, inflammation, edema, and hemorrhage in the subacromial bursa as well as rotator cuff. Stage 2, fibrosis and tendinitis. Stage 3, rotator cuff reaches to a point of failure. Sixth shoulder problem is rotator cuff tear arthropathy. Here, humeral head migrates proximally to abut the coracoacromial arch. Number 7, frank rupture of the rotator cuff or rotator cuff tear due to acute trauma. MRI is the investigation of choice. CT arthrography is equally sensitive. Treatment of rotator cuff pathology. Number 1, non-operative treatment, and number 2, operative treatment. Non-operative treatment consists of physical therapy and special rotator cuff exercises, steroid injections. Steroid injections should not be repeated more than 3 times a year and is only advisable in stage 1 and 2 diseases according to near staging. Stage 3 disease does not normally respond to conservative measures. Third option is surgical option. Surgical treatment options are, number 1, arthroscopic subacromial decompression. Number 2, arthroscopic subacromial decompression with mini open tendon repair. Number 3, arthroscopic tendon repair. Number 4, arthroscopic subacromial decompression with an open tendon repair, which is the most popular of all the options. Number 5, massive rotator cuff tear. Rockwood has described acromial decompression and debridement. Management of massive cuff tear measures described are, number 1, mobilizing the torn rotator cuff on either side. Number 2, the interval slide, where the complete release of the rotator interval and coracohumeral ligament down to the base of the coracoid allows supraspinatus to be mobilized further. Number 3, transfer of the upper portion of the subscapularis. Number 4, mobilizing the posterior and medial aspect of the cup on the glenoid rim. Number 5, synthetic material or allografts used to bridge the interval. And number 6, latissimus dorsi transfer. Calcific tendinitis usually occurs between 5th and 6th decade of life. Acute and chronic are the two phases of this condition. Pathology is the degeneration of collagen in association with calcium salt deposition with focus of necrotic tissue and inflammation. Treatment of calcific tendinitis during acute phase is steroid injections and anti-inflammatories. Since calcium may be a liquid, attempt at aspiration is helpful. Physiotherapy is advised. Arthroscopic treatment to remove the calcific deposit is also been described. Biceps tendon problems at the shoulder joint. Number one, biceps tendinitis and rupture. Though speed test and Yergusen signs are described, they are not very specific. Treatment, tenodesis, either direct suturing, transosseous suturing or keyhole technique where proximal biceps tendon is held into the bone using a keyhole aperture in the proximal humerus. Second biceps problem is biceps tendon subluxation, usually associated with rotator cuff tear. Operative treatment is generally indicated. Number three, superior labral lesions, also called slap lesion, superior labrum anterior posterior lesion, which can be type 1, fraying with intact biceps anchor, type 2, detachment of biceps anchor, type 3, bucket handle tear of the labrum with intact biceps, and type 4, bucket handle tear into the biceps insertion. Diagnosis of slap is usually arthroscopic. Recent reports have indicated high success rate with arthroscopic reattachment of slap lesion. Arthritis and degenerative disorders of the shoulder. Number 1, osteoarthritis. Number 2, rheumatoid arthritis. Number 3, avascular necrosis of humerus. Etiology of AVN of humerus is usually multifactorial. Corticosteroids, alcohol, sickle cell disease and other causes are also being blamed. Classification of AVN of humerus is described by Near into 4 stages. Stage 1, subtle changes. Stage 2, meniscal sign representing subchondral bone changes. Stage 3, step off sign with obvious collapse of the subchondral bone. And stage 4, incongruencies of joint secondary to collapse. Number 4 or fourth degenerative shoulder problem is post-traumatic arthritis. Fractures, dislocations, subluxations or after surgical intervention for instability are the common causes. Fifth cause of degenerative shoulder problem is cuff tear arthropathy. Sixth, due to post-septic arthritis sequelae. Surgical options available for degenerate shoulder joint are number 1, glenohumeral arthroplasty. Infection is an absolute contraindication for arthroplasty. Number 2, debridement and soft tissue balancing for instability. Number 3, humeral head resection, which can be salvage procedure in resistant infections as well as failed arthroplasties. Number 4 is shoulder arthrodesis, which has fallen out of fashion. Common indication is the shoulder with muscle imbalance like brachial plexus palsy for shoulder arthrodesis. Commonly used prosthetic design is Near's shoulder replacement. Modular Near shoulder replacements are recently available. Surface replacement and bipolar hemiarthroplasties are also used. It's important to get the appropriate version of the components during insertion of the prosthesis. Rehabilitation after arthroplasties is equally important. Near's three phases of shoulder rehabilitation are Phase 1, passive motion in forward elevation and external rotation. Phase 2, active assisted exercises of the shoulder generally begin at 6 to 8 weeks after surgery. And Phase 3, advanced muscle stretching and progressive resistive strengthening exercises usually at 3 months. Complications of glenohumeral arthroplasties are infection 0.5%, nerve injuries mainly axillary nerve, intraoperative fractures, postoperative instability 1-2%, postoperative rotator cuff tear and prosthetic loosening. Non-constrained arthroplasty component designs are number 1, cemented metal humeral component and cemented polyethylene glenoid component. Number 2, non-porous press-fit humeral components. Number 3, porous-coated humerus component This causes significant bone loss during revision surgery. Number 4, metal-backed glenoid component, which is out of favor at present. And number 5, porous ingrowth glenoid components. Acromioclavicular joint osteoarthritis, most valuable diagnostic tool is local anesthetic injection. Treatment of acromioclavicular joint arthritis is open or arthroscopic resection of the distal clavicle. Open resection is described by Mumford. Frozen shoulder or adhesive capsulitis. Frozen shoulder can be either primary or secondary. Secondary frozen shoulder causes can be either intrinsic or extrinsic. Intrinsic causes of secondary frozen shoulder are rotator cuff diseases or post-traumatic scarring. Extrinsic causes of secondary frozen shoulder are referred pain due to cervical, wrist, hand, elbow or myocardial infarction. Frozen shoulder has different stages of evolution. Stage 1, capillary proliferation or pre-adhesive stage. Stage 2 is adhesive stage, which is the most painful stage. Stage 3 is maturation phase, which leaves capsular contractures and is relatively pain-free. Stage 4 is capsular contracture. Treatment goal is to relieve pain and to restore motion and function. Available non-surgical modalities are non-steroidal anti-inflammatories, steroid injections, not advisable to use too frequently, and active as well as active assisted range of motion rehabilitation programs. Operative treatment. Number 1, manipulation and anesthesia, mainly when the patients don't respond to conservative measures. Number 2, accurate arthroscopic release of contracted scapuloligamentous structures and bursal adhesions, which is also known as brisement. And number 3, open release of contractures. Next topic here is glenohumeral instability. Glenohumeral instability is male predominant disorder, 9:1 incidence, male is to female. It's 1.7% incidence in Sweden between the ages of 18 to 70 years. Acute trauma is the most common mechanism of etiology of glenohumeral instability. Classification of glenohumeral joint instability is under the following 4 headings. Number 1, mechanism of instability. Number 2, direction of instability. Number 3, circumstance causing instability. And number 4, degree of instability. Number 1, mechanism can be traumatic, microtrauma or atraumatic. Number 2, direction can be anterior, posterior, inferior, superior or multidirectional. Number 3, circumstance can be acute, recurrent, chronic, involuntary and voluntary. Number 4, degree of instability can be subluxation or dislocation. Dislocation is generally considered acute if it is within 24 hours of presentation, recurrent if multiple episodes before presentation, involuntary when individuals have no desire, and voluntary when an individual has a desire to dislocate. Anterior instability. Points to note in anterior instability are: its most frequent form of instability, apprehension test is positive, Job's relocation test may be positive, increased amount of translation compared to the normal soid, also called near gliding test in anterior instability, is suggestive of an element of multidirectional involvement. Radiological findings in anterior instability are Hill-Sachs lesion, anterior glenoid rim defect, which is best seen on West Point axillary view, and Bankart lesion. Treatment is either conservative or operative. Old-fashioned operative bony procedures and soft tissue procedures like Puttiplatt, Bristow, Magnussen-Stock, Weber proximal humeral osteotomy, these are out of fashion because of early osteoarthritic changes after these procedures in these shoulders. Main pathology is in the capsulo-ligamentous structures of the shoulder joint or bony avulsion of the ligament in Bankart lesion. Treatment of choice in anteroinferior capsular laxity or anterior instability is anteroinferior capsular shift operation with Bankart repair if Bankart lesion is present. Goal is to restore the anatomy. Multidirectional instability needs inferior capsular shift procedure. Arthroscopic capsular shift procedures have been described. Posterior dislocation, less common and easily missed dislocation, may result from electric shock or epileptic fit. Posterior stress test is helpful provocative test. In inferior or superior instability, look for sulcus sign. Multidirectional instability, patient will have equal displacement in all three directions. Sulcus sign will be positive. We need to differentiate between asymptomatic hyperlaxity from multidirectional instability, which is symptomatic. These shoulders may have more severe component in one direction with multidirectional laxity. The elbow joint. Reported normal carrying angle in males is 6.83 and in females 12.65. Average normal range of pronation and supination is from 71 degrees of pronation to 81 degrees of supination. Elbow joint stability. Elbow is medially supported by medial collateral ligament. Medial collateral ligament has a very strong anterior medial collateral ligament, posterior oblique portion of medial collateral ligament, and a transverse intervening segment. Medial collateral instability is difficult to repair primarily. Technique described is using Pramaris longus graft, which is more popular. Lateral ligament complex, shape of articular surface, and anterior capsule also provides stability to the joint. Arthroscopic surgery of the elbow. Portals are anterolateral portal, 1 cm distal and 1 cm anterior to the lateral epicondyle. Beware of radial nerve. Anteromedial portal, 1 cm proximal and 1 cm anterior to the medial epicondyle. Switching stick technique is helpful. Midlateral portal is between capitulum, radial head and olecranon and is the safest portal. Posterior portal through the olecranon fossa, described by Outbridge and Kasiwaji, so-called OK procedure. Rheumatoid arthritis of the elbow. Radiological staging is stage 1, osteoporosis and soft tissue damage. Stage 2, mild or moderate degree of bone erosion, joint space not less than 1 mm. Stage 3, more advanced with narrowing of the joint. And stage 4, extensive destruction of the articular cartilage. Elbow replacement can be constrained or unconstrained, which is more popular. Kudo or suture systems are commonly used in UK. Reported 5.5 year survival is 83%. Main post-op complications are ulnar nerve injury and dislocations. Approach to the elbow are: number 1, posterior direct triceps splitting approach. Number 2, extensive posterolateral approach. Number 3, Mayo Clinic posteromedial exposure, which is a periosteal dissection of the triceps from the ulna or olecranon. Let's move on to the orthopedic problems of the hand. Congenital anomalies of the hand and upper extremity are classified by Swanson's as: number 1, failure of formation of parts. Number 2, failure of separation of parts. Number 3, duplication. Number 4, overgrowth of or hypoplasia. Number 6, congenital constriction bands. And number 7, generalized skeletal abnormalities. Reported etiology of congenital hand disorders are 30% due to genetic, 10% non-genetic and 60% unknown etiology. Swanson's classification of ulnar club hand is 1. Hypoplastic ulna, 2. Total absent ulna, 3. Humeroradial synostosis or congenital arthrodesis of the elbow joint, 4. Deficient ulna and absent wrist. Heekel's classification of radial club hand is 1. Short radius, 2. Hypoplastic radius, 3. Partial absent radius, 4. Absent radius. Associated conditions with radial club hand are 1. Fanconi syndrome with aplastic anemia, 2. Thrombocytopenia or TAR syndrome, TAR. Number 3. Heart anomaly, Holt-Oram-Lewis syndrome, 4. Vater syndrome. Treatment of radial club hand options are: number 1. Early cases, splinting. Number 2. Manipulation with or without soft tissue release. Number 3. Late stages, centralization of the distal wrist over the ulna, ideally done within first year of life, described by Swanson. Syndactyly can be complete or incomplete. Simple if only skin bridge, or complex syndactyly if underlying structures are also duplicated. Most commonest syndactyly is between middle and ring fingers, followed by ring and little fingers. Syndactyly is more common in white males. Associated syndromes are Poland syndrome, Streeter's dysplasia, and Apert syndrome, also called acrocephalosyndactyly. Polydactyly can be incomplete with soft tissue duplication only, complete finger but without duplicate metacarpal, or complete with its own metacarpal. It can also be classified as post-axial or ulnar polydactyly, or pre-axial, that is radial digits and thumb duplication. Thumb polydactyly is classified by Wassel as 1. Bifid distal phalanx, 2. Duplicate distal phalanx, 3. Bifid proximal phalanx, 4. Duplicate proximal phalanx, 5. Bifid metacarpal, 6. Duplicate metacarpal, and 7. Triphalangism. Hypoplastic thumb classified by Bloth is 1. Short thumb with hypoplastic Thena muscles, 2. Number 1 with adducted MCP joint, that is short thumb with hypoplastic Thena muscles with adducted MCP joint. Number 3, deficient metacarpal. Number 4, floating thumb. And number 5, absent thumb. Deviated digits are called: number 1, clinodactyly, which is lateral plane deviation, occasionally needs corrective closing wedge osteotomy. Number 2, camptodactyly is AP plane deformity. Easy way to remember here is clino begins with CL for lateral plane, campto begins with CA for AP deformity. Third deviated digit deformity is Kerner deformity. Kerner deformity is curling of the distal phalanx of little finger. Number 4, delta phalanx is wedged phalanx as well as physis. Congenital trigger finger or trigger thumb, 30% of them resolve by the age of 1. Correction of the deformity before the age of 2 is advisable to avoid fixed flexion contractures. Central hand deficiencies are classified by Bloth for cleft hand as: number 1, typical cleft hand. Number 2, atypical severe lobster claw. And number 3, absent ray. Congenital radioulnar synostosis is associated with fetal alcohol syndrome, and osteotomies for disabling pronation are considered. Congenital dislocation of the radial head is treated by resection of the radial head after maturity. Made lung deformity is abnormal growth of the distal radial epiphysis, with premature fusion of the ulnar half of the distal radius. Surgical treatment options are: number 1, osteotomies of distal radius; 2, Soe-Capanji technique; 3, late stages wrist arthrodesis. Rheumatoid arthritis of the hand and wrist. Clinical findings may be: 1, increased warmth of the hand, tenderness, swelling; 2, synovitis with joint and tendon swellings; 3, rheumatoid nodules; 4, muscle wasting and decreased muscle strength due to atrophy; 5, loss of joint motion; 6, deformities. Deformities in rheumatoid hand are: 1, palmar subluxation and ulnar deviation of the carpus; 2, radial deviation and dorsal displacement of the metacarpals, which is opposite deformity to that of carpus; 3, ulnar deviation and flexion of the digits, which is opposite to the deformity at the metacarpal joint; 4, distal radio ulnar joint subluxation forming caput ulnae syndrome due to dorsal subluxation of the ulnar head; 5, tendon ruptures. Owen-Jackson syndrome is rupture of extensor tendons of ring and little finger; extensor pollicis longus ruptures; rupture of wrist extensors. Manifold syndrome is rupture of distal or digital flexor tendons at the wrist joint. 6, deformity in rheumatoid hand are deformities of the digits. So deformities of the digits can be: swan neck deformity, Boutonnais deformity, joint subluxation, joint dislocation, ulnar deviation of the digits, fixed flexion contractures of the joints, joint destruction, floppy joints and stiff joints. Surgery in rheumatoid arthritis are addressed to following main principles. 1, control of the medically resistant inflammatory process, example is tenosynovectomy; 2, preservation of the function prior to the onset of deformity; 3, surgery to correct the deformity; and finally, surgery for pain. Common surgeries in rheumatoid prior to the onset of deformity are: 1, synovectomy; 2, carpal tunnel release; 3, restoration of ruptured tendons; 4, wrist balancing by tendon transfer and dorsal stabilization techniques. Commonly done surgical procedures after the onset of the deformity are: 1, Darax procedure; 2, Bowers technique, which is hemiresection of distal ulna; 3, Soe-Capanji technique; 4, wrist arthroplasty; 5, wrist arthrodesis. Nail buffs technique of wrist arthrodesis is insertion of Steinman pin through the third metacarpal, as well as MCP joint replacement of third MCP joint. AO compression plate also can be used for wrist arthrodesis. Metacarpophalangeal joint in rheumatoid arthritis. Factors responsible for the deformity at metacarpophalangeal joint are broadly grouped under the headings: 1, forces normally acting; 2, anatomical reasons; 3, rheumatoid disease itself. Forces normally acting are: 1, gravity; 2, lateral pinch; and 3, power grasp. Anatomical reasons for the deformity are: 1, asymmetrical shape of the metacarpal head; 2, unequal collateral ligament length; and 3, asymmetrical intrinsic muscles to the small finger. Rheumatoid disease causing deformities at MCP joint are due to: 1, synovitis; 2, collateral ligament rupture; 3, tenosynovitis; 4, joint destruction; 5, wrist deformities, etc. Main deformities at MCP joint is ulnar deviation of the MCP joint. Surgical procedure before the onset of deformities are: rebalancing the long extensor tendons, intrinsic muscle transfers or intrinsic muscle divisions. Correction of the established deformity usually requires MCP joint replacement. Proximal interphalangeal joint affection in rheumatoid. Swan neck deformity is extension at PIP joint. Factors contributing to the swan neck deformity are intrinsic contracture, joint affection, synovitis, joint destruction, destruction of soft tissues around the joint like palmar plate, capsular contracture, destruction of retinacular ligaments and muscle imbalance. Grading of the swan neck deformity is done by Neil Buff and Melinda as grade 1, flexion of PIP joint in all positions of MCP joint. Grade 2, limited flexion of PIP joint when MCP joint is extended due to intrinsic tightness. Grade 3, limited PIP joint movement in all positions of MCP joint. Grade 4, PIP joint stiff due to joint destruction. Treatment of swan neck deformity. Grade 1 and 2, Neil Buff and Melinda, flexor tenosynovectomy. Grade 3 and 4, Neil Buff and Melinda, arthroplasty or arthrodesis. Bottineau's deformity of the finger is flexion at PIP joint and extension at DIP joint. Two tests described for Bottineau deformity are number 1, Elson's test, which is demonstrated by asking to extend the PIP joint against resistance with PIP joint held in 90 degrees of flexion. Second test is intrinsic tightness test, which is demonstrated by extending the proximal interphalangeal joint to its maximum and demonstrating passive loss of distal interphalangeal joint flexion. Staging of Bottineau's by Neil Buff and Melinda, classified as number 1, mild, 10 to 15 degrees lag of extension at PIP joint. Stage 2, moderate, 30 to 40 degrees of lag of extension at PIP joint. And stage 3 is severe with fixed flexion posture of PIP joint. Treatment, mild stage, extensor tenotomy over the middle phalanx. Moderate, central slip shortening, mobilization of the lateral bands, tenotomy or PIP fusion. Severe stage deformity will need PIP joint fusion. Thumb deformities in rheumatoid arthritis. Melinda and Neil Buff classification of thumb deformity are type 1, Bottineau deformity, which has flexion at MCP joint of thumb. Type 2, combination of Bottineau and swan neck deformity, that is 1 and 3. Type 3 is swan neck deformity, which has extension at the MCP joint with adduction or adducted CMC joint of the thumb. Type 4 is gamekeeper's thumb, and type 5 is arthritis mutilans. Let's look into type 1 Neil Buff thumb deformity. Bottineau deformity of the thumb is subclassified as mild, which is flexible MCP joint, moderate, when it is fixed in flexion but passively corrects with hyperextension of IP joint, severe, will have fixed flexion deformity of MCP joint. Treatment, mild disease, synovectomy and extensor mechanism reconstruction, moderate disease, MCP joint arthrodesis or arthroplasty, severe Bottineau of the thumb will need MCP joint arthrodesis or arthroplasty. Type 3 swan neck deformity of the thumb is subclassified as mild, where CMC joint will have minimal subluxation and deformity, moderate, when subluxation and deformity of the CMC joint is passively correctable, severe is when CMC joint is dislocated and fixed adduction contracture is present. Treatment, mild swan neck needs conservative measures, moderate swan neck of the thumb needs CMC joint hemiarthroplasty, interposition arthroplasty or tenodesis of MCP joint, severe swan neck of the thumb will need CMC joint hemiarthroplasty, interposition arthroplasty with MCP joint fusion. Arthritis mutilans is a severe form or variant of rheumatoid arthritis often associated with psoriasis. Osteoarthritis in the hand. Only 15% of the men are symptomatic, even though they have the disease. Bouchard's nodes are over the PIP joint and Haberden's nodes are over the DIP joint. Some of the features. Dupuytren's contracture. Dupuytren's contracture is a disabling fibromatosis involving palmar aponeurosis. Nodular thickening form in the fascia and may progress onto the longitudinal bands, resulting in fixed flexion contracture. Dupuytren's diathesis refers to predisposition of some patients for multiple areas of involvement, positive family history, early onset of the disease, and disease affecting number one, ulnar aspect of the hand, number two, dorsum of the fingers called knuckle pads, number three, plantar fibromatosis, and number four, penis, also called Peyronie's disease. Anatomical normal bands are longitudinal pretendinous bands, spiral bands, natatory ligament, lateral digital sheath, Grayson's ligament, and Cleland's ligament. Pathological cords are number one, central cord formed by longitudinal pretendinous band, number two, spiral cord formed by combination of spiral band, pretendinous band, lateral digital sheath, vertical band, and Grayson's ligament. Number three, lateral cord formed by lateral digital sheath. Number four, retrovascular cord arises from digital fascia dorsal to the neurovascular bundle. Fifth, commonest cord combination is central lateral cord combination. Pathophysiology of Dupuytren's nodules. Nodules are formed by smooth muscle-like cells called myofibroblasts. Proliferation of myofibroblasts within the nodules of the Dupuytren's contracture is a slowly progressive phenomena consisting of number one, proliferative stage with increased cellularity, number two, involutional stage, and number three, residual stage where myofibroblasts are replaced by dense collagen cord. Origin of myofibroblasts is unknown. Intrinsic theory states that fibroblasts differentiate into myofibroblasts, and extrinsic theory states myofibroblasts have subdermal origin which migrate down into the palm of fascia. Oxygen-free radical is also been suggested to play a role. Higher incidence of Dupuytren's is reported in association with epilepsy, diabetes mellitus, chronic alcoholism, chronic pulmonary TB, chronic lung diseases. 10% of this condition will have positive family history. Treatment at present is surgical. Other tried methods with no documented success are injection of enzymes, corticosteroids, superoxide dismutase, physiotherapy and splinting, radiation and gamma interferon. Surgical treatment does not cure the condition. Goal of surgical treatment is to modify its progression and to improve function. Indications for surgical intervention are 1. Positive tabletop test, 2. MCP joint fixed flexion more than 30 degrees, 3. Any significant PIP joint contracture, 4. If night pain is a symptom, remote possibility of fibrosarcoma should be considered. Treatment of associated disorders in Dupuytren's. Number one, if Dupuytren's is associated with trigger finger release should precede Dupuytren's treatment. Number two, carpal tunnel syndrome treatment can wait as it may improve after correction of Dupuytren's disease. Surgical options are 1. Fasciotomy, 2. Regional fasciectomy, 3. Radical fasciectomy, 4. Dermofasciectomy for complicated and high-risk cases, and 5. Amputation as a salvage procedure. incisions used. McCosh has popularized transverse incision, which is healed by granulation tissue. Z-plasties can be used. Brunner has mentioned zigzag incision for Dupuytren's excision. Postoperative management involves static night extension splintage and active range of motion exercises during the day. Patient should be warned about the following complications in Dupuytren's contracture surgical intervention. Number one, neurovascular problems. Number two, immediate wound problems. Number three, recurrence. Number four, amputations. Number five, neuromas. And number six, incomplete correction of the deformity. First, in the hand and forearm. Indications and principles of tendon transfers in the upper limb are: number one, irreparable nerve damage has been confirmed. Number two, loss of muscle function due to loss of muscle structure itself after trauma. Number three, non-progressive or slowly progressive neurological disorder. Number four, synergistic action muscles are to be used for better results. Number five, joint contracture should not be present. Number six, donor muscle should have adequate power, because after transfer, power of the muscle goes down by one grade. Number seven, sufficient amplitude in the transferred muscle is advisable. Normal amplitude of wrist motors is around 33 millimeters. Finger extensors is around 50 millimeters and finger flexors is 70 millimeters. Number eight, satisfactory straight line of pull is provided for the transferred muscle where possible. Number nine, functional integrity must be preserved. Tendon not expected to perform more than one function or over two joints. Surgical considerations. Number one, timing of the transfer. Early transfer as an internal splint is being described by Birkenhalter in radial nerve palsies as pronator teres transfer to the extensor carpi radialis brevis. Number two, early tendon transfers are preferred for bad prognostic nerve injuries like proximal nerve lesion, irreparable nerve damage, or lesion with statistically shown poor chance of recovery. Number three, muscles available and muscles lost are charted and careful selection of the transfer option should be considered. Radial nerve palsy. Functions lost are: 1. Wrist extension. 2. MCP joint extension. 3. Abduction and extension of thumb. Jones transfer is: number 1. Pronator teres to extensor carpi radialis brevis for wrist extension. Number 2. Flexor carpi ulnaris to extensor digitorum communis for MCP joint extension. And number 3. Palmaris longus to extensor pollicis longus for thumb function. Some authors believe that FCU is not dispensable muscle and they use FCR instead. Median nerve palsy. Lesions are: number one, sensory deficit. Number two, low level lesion has deficient opponents as well as abduction of the thumb. Number three, high median nerve lesion lost tendons are flexor digitorum superficialis, flexor digitorum profundus of index and long fingers, flexor pollicis longus, and flexor carpi radialis. Treatment: sensory deficit, full thickness pedicle skin graft transfers from the little finger are described. Low level injury: number one, one half of flexor carpi ulnaris is converted into pulley. Flexor digitorum superficialis of ring finger is looped through this and rooted to the base. Treatment: number one, brachioradialis is rerouted with the use of tendon graft around the base of the third metacarpal and fixed to the proximal phalanx of the thumb. Number two, loss of flexion at MCP joint can be dealt with static or dynamic correction. Static correction for the MCP joint flexion are: by blocking passive extension of MCP joint, either bone block or arthrodesis, or resist the extension of MCP joint by olaplate capsulorraphy. Dynamic correction is done by transfer of flexor digitorum superficialis to the lateral bands of the fingers or A2 pulleys to act as flexors of MCP joint. High ulnar nerve palsy. High ulnar nerve palsy, we need to address paralyzed flexor carpi ulnaris and flexor digitorum profundus of the ring and little fingers. Flexor carpi radialis is split transferred to flexor carpi ulnaris. Flexor digitorum profundus is denudeased to neighboring intact flexor digitorum profundus. Tumors of the hand and wrist. Number one, ganglion of the wrist contributes to 70% of all soft tissue tumors of the hand. Most common sites for wrist ganglions are dorsal carpal ganglion from scapulolunate ligament, 60-70%. Olar carpal ganglion from tendon sheets of flexor carpi radialis and abductor pollicis longus. Retinacular ganglion cysts appear in A1 or A2 pulleys. Treatment, reassurance, aspiration followed by immobilization or surgical excision. Number two, other tumors of the hand are lipoma, benign giant cell tumors of the tendon sheath, also known as pigmented villonodular synovitis, epidermal cyst, glomus tumor, enchondromas, osteochondromas, and osteoid osteomas. Glomus tumor, 50% of them occur in the subungual region. Severe pain and cold sensitivity are common symptoms, may be arising from the blood vessels. MRI is helpful. Recurrence is very common and it can be multicentric. Malignant tumors of the hand are very rare. Tendon injuries in the hand. Finger flexor pulleys are A1 over MCP joint, A2 over proximal phalanx, A3 over PIP joint, and A4 over the middle phalanx. Most important pulleys are A2 and A4 pulleys. In between A1, A2, A3, A4 pulleys, three cruciate pulleys exist. They are C1, C2, and C3. Tendon nutrition. Number one, longitudinal vessels enter the palm. Number two, segmental branches enter the tendon sheath through the vincula. Number three, vessels enter the tendon at the osseous insertion. And number four, diffusion through synovial fluid. Flexor tendon zones are 5 zones. Zone 1, distal to the superficial flexor insertion. Zone 2, no man's land, which is within the flexor tendon sheath. Zone 3 is in the palm. Zone 4 in the carpal tunnel, and zone 5 proximal to the carpal tunnel. Modified Kestler is the commonly used stitch in acute tendon repairs. Extensor tendon zones are different for fingers and thumb. Finger zones are 8. Zone 1 is over DIP joint or mallet deformity. Zone 2 is over the middle phalanx. Zone 3 is over the IP joint or Bottineau deformity. Zone 4 is over proximal phalanx. Zone 5 is over MCP joint. Zone 6 is over metacarpals. Zone 7 is at the wrist level. And zone 8 is over distal forearm. Zones of the thumb are 6. Zone 1 over IP joint. Zone 2 over proximal phalanx. Zone 3 over MCP joint or Bottineau deformity. Zone 4 is over metacarpal of the thumb. Zone 5 is over the wrist. And zone 6 over the distal forearm. Doyle's classification of mallet finger is type 1, tendon discontinuity with or without small avulsion of bone. Type 2, laceration with loss of tendon continuity. Type 3, deep aberration with loss of substance of the tendon and skin. Type 4, associated with significant intra-articular injury. 20-50% of the articular surface is involved. Late reconstruction surgeries of flexor tendons are Number one, secondary suturing, which is within 4 weeks of injury. Number two, flexor tendon grafting. Number three, staged tendon reconstruction. Number four, pulley reconstruction. And number five, flexor tenolysis. Let's look into wrist instability and ligamentous injuries of the wrist. Perilunate and lunate dislocation. Mayfield has described four stages: scapholunate diastasis, perilunate dislocation, lunotricuspid diastasis, and lunate ulnar dislocation. Pathoanatomy is: number one, scapholunate ligament rupture or scaphoid fracture. Number two, capitolunate dislocation. Number three, lunotricuspid disruption. Number four, dorsal lunocarpal ligament failure. And the last event is lunate dislocation. Treatment: number one, associated scaphoid fracture with lunate instability must be internally fixed. Number two, closed reduction and percutaneous pinning is an option. Number three, if reduction is not congruent, open reduction by dorsal as well as ulnar combined approach is described. Carpal instability. We have two carpal rows, proximal and distal, and they are interconnected by the scaphoid. So we have three units in the carpus: proximal, distal, and scaphoid. Carpal instability can be: number one, carpal instability dissociate, or number two, carpal instability non-dissociate. Dissociate means bones within the carpal rows are dissociated due to intraosseous ligament ruptures. Non-dissociate means carpal bones within the rows behave as one unit with intact interosseous. To look into is lunate position. That will determine whether it is dorsal or ulnar intercalated segmental instability. Proximal carpal row is the intercalated segment between the radiocarpal and midcarpal joints. And number one, DC, that is dorsal intercalated segment instability, is when lunate is facing dorsally in the lateral X-ray, which can either be carpal instability dissociate or carpal instability non-dissociate. Scapholunate angle in DC is increased. Number two, VC, or ulnar intercalated segment instability, is when lunate is facing ulnar in the lateral X-ray, which again can be either CID or CIND. Scapholunate angle is decreased in VC. X-ray views in carpal instability are: number one, anteroposterior view in neutral, radial, and ulnar deviation. Number two, true lateral in neutral, flexion, and extension. Normal scapholunate angle in true lateral view is 30 to 60 degrees. Number three, oblique views. Number four, piezotrichetral views. Number five, wrist fist views. Terry Thomas sign is present if more than 3 millimeters of gap between the scaphoid and lunate exists in wrist fist views. Mayo's classification of carpal instability: number one, perilunate carpal instability. Number two, radiocarpal carpal instability. And number three, midcarpal. So number one, perilunate is carpal instability dissociate, which can be either DC or VC. Subgroup scapholunate dissociation is DC, and subgroup lunotricuspid dissociation is VC. Second group is radiocarpal instability, which is radiocarpal instability non-dissociate. Subgroups are VC, DC, and ulnar translation. Third major group is midcarpal instability, which is carpal instability non-dissociate. Subgroups are: one, tricuspid, which is more often VC and can also be DC. Subgroup 2, scapho trapezoidal is more often VC and can also be DC. Subgroup 3, capitolunate instability is more often DC and it can also be VC. Subgroup 4, diffuse laxity is more often DC and can also be VC. Treatment of perilunate instability. Let's look into dorsal intercalated segmental instability first. Number 1, acute injury, closed reduction and pinning, and if necessary, open capsular reconstruction. Number 2, chronic injury, treatment can be dynamic or static reconstruction. Dynamic reconstruction is Blatt's procedure, which is dorsal capsulodesis. Static procedure for chronic dorsal intercalated segmental instability is like Watson's triscaphe fusion. Number 3, salvage procedures are proximal row carpectomy, radial styloidectomy, four bone fusions, or wrist fusion. Let's look into volar intercalated segmental instability. Number 1, acute injuries, close treatment. Number 2, chronic injuries can be dealt with dynamic ligament reconstructions or capsulodesis or static intercarpal fusions. Number 3, salvage procedures are proximal row carpectomies and wrist fusion. TFCC lesions can be traumatic or degenerative. Few words on scaphoid fractures. Scaphoid fractures may not be seen on x-rays until 10 to 21 days. Complications are non-unions and avascular necrosis. 90% of scaphoid fractures will heal with good outcome. Proximal pole AVN is also called Prieser's disease. Roos has mentioned bone graft technique for non-union of the scaphoid. Roos approach is volar approach to scaphoid. Proximal pole is better reached by dorsal approach. Scapholunate advanced collapse or slack wrist, SLAC. Slack wrist is manifested following scaphoid fractures or scapholunate dissociation due to degeneration of the radioscaphoid and capitolunate joints. Radiolunate joint is paired in slack wrist. Four stages are described. Stage 1, radial styloid and scaphoid abutment. Stage 2, radial scaphoid articulation is affected. Stage 3, capitolunate joint affected with or without scaphocapitate joint involvement. Stage 4 is migration of the capitate proximally. Kienbock's disease is avascular necrosis of lunate. Stages and treatment described by Stahl, which is modified by Lichtman, is based on X-ray evaluation. Stage 1, sclerosis, which is treated conservatively. Stage 2, fragmentation, treated by radial shortening or ulnar lengthening. Stage 3, collapse of lunate, treatment is controversial. Triscaphe or capitohamate fusion to reduce load on the lunate is advised. Stage 4 is radiocarpal degeneration. Salvage procedure like wrist fusion may be necessary. Brachial plexus injury. Branches of the brachial plexus mnemonic is 310 and 355, which is mentioned in the previous section. Liefert has classified brachial plexus injury into number 1, open injury. Number 2, closed injury, usually road traffic accident, can be either supraclavicular or infraclavicular. Supraclavicular can be preganglionic or postganglionic. Infraclavicular usually involves branches from the trunk. Number 3, radiation therapy induced brachial plexus injury. And number 4, obstetric brachial palsy, which can be Erb's palsy, which is upper root palsy, Klumpke's, which is lower root palsy, or mixed group. Bad prognostic factors are preganglionic injury and high velocity injury. Preganglionic injury can be recognized by winging of the scapula, Horner's sign, denervation of the dorsal neck muscles, pseudomeningocele on myelogram, normal histamine test, and MRI abnormalities. Erb's palsy clinical picture is of waiter's tip hand, arm is internally rotated, elbow extended and flexed wrist. Treatment: open injuries are always explored. Closed injuries: birth injuries are observed up to a year with early physiotherapy input. If biceps does not recover by 3 months, it's a bad prognostic factor. High velocity injuries: early exploration is recommended as the chance of recovery with higher velocity injury is not great. Surgical options are: number 1, neurolysis; number 2, neurotmesis. Example is the transfer of the intercostal nerves to musculocutaneous nerve. Number 3, nerve interposition grafting. Number 4, reconstructive procedures. Principles of reconstructive procedures in brachial plaque palsy are: 1, shoulder stabilization by triceps transfer or arthrodesis. Number 2, to achieve elbow flexion by Steindler's flexoroplasty, latissimus dorsi transfer, pectoralis transfer or triceps transfer. Nerve entrapment syndromes in the upper extremity. Pathogenesis: 1, anatomic; 2, postural; 3, developmental like congenital bands; 4, inflammatory as in tenosynovitis; 5, metabolic and endocrine causes; 6, tumors like ganglions; 7, trauma as in dislocations or compartment syndromes; 8, iatrogenic due to nerve injections. Degree of nerve damage is related to severity of compression rather than duration. Common presentations are due to: 1, physiologic conduction block; 2, neuropraxia; 3, exonotmesis; or 4, combination of these. Carpal tunnel syndrome: Tinel's sign and Phelan's test are provocative tests. Electrodiagnostic accuracy at present for carpal tunnel syndrome is about 80 to 90%. Treatment: 1, open surgical release of transverse carpal ligament, which is the most popular. Number 2, endoscopic carpal tunnel release is not universally accepted because of complications. Pronator teres syndrome: this is entrapment of the median nerve between the two heads of pronator teres. Other structures entrapping median nerve in the same region are: number 1, Lacertus fibrosus, which is a fibrous structure at the origin of the pronator teres. Number 2, ligament of Struthers is a band from the distal end of the front of the humerus to the pronator teres. Please note, arcade of Struthers is different from ligament of Struthers. Fibrous arch of flexor digitorum superficialis. Muscle stressing tests for localization of these different spots of entrapment or sites of entrapment are: 1, pain on resisted pronation of the forearm with elbow extended implicates the pronator teres syndrome. Number 2, pain on supination as well as resisted flexion implicates Lacertus fibrosus. Number 3, pain on resisted flexion of PIP joint of the middle finger implicates arch of flexor digitorum superficialis as a culprit. Treatment mainly relies on clinical examination. Only 20% show delay in nerve conduction studies. Anterior interosseous nerve syndrome: this is purely motor deficit, mainly affects flexor pollicis longus and flexor digitorum profundus to the index finger. Tinel's sign is usually negative. EMG is helpful. Most common constricting structure is the tendinous origin of the deep head of pronator teres. Treatment of pronator teres syndrome and anterior interosseous syndrome is surgical decompression. Ulnar nerve entrapment. Cubital tunnel syndrome: clinical testing is by extreme flexion of the elbow maintained for 1 to 2 minutes. Frumens sign may be positive. Clawing of ring and little finger is seen. EMG studies to confirm the diagnosis is very helpful. Entrapment may be at different sites. Number one, at the arcade of Struthers, which is a ligamentous structure extending from the medial head of triceps to the medial intermuscular septum. Number two, anomalous fibrous band within the forearm. Number three, in between the two heads of flexor carpi ulnaris. Number four, fibrous arch between the two heads of flexor carpi ulnaris, also known as arcade of Osborne. Treatment options. Number one, steroid injections should be avoided. Number two, ulnar nerve neurolysis. Number three, neurolysis with anterior transposition, which can be subcutaneous or submuscular nerve transfer. Number four, medial epicondylectomy. Ulnar tunnel syndrome or Guyon's canal syndrome. Guyon's canal is 4 cm long tunnel. Transverse carpal and piezo hamate ligaments form the flow. Roof of Guyon's canal is formed by ulnar carpal ligament and walls are formed by pisiform and hook of hamate. Treatment is neurolysis. MRI is useful to rule out cystic lesions. Allen's test may be positive with ulnar artery thrombosis. Radial nerve entrapment. Different levels of entrapment are: number one, spiral groove of the humerus trapped by fibrous arch under the lateral head of triceps. Number two, lateral intermuscular septum. Number three, proximal supinator. Two symptoms are pain and weakness. Two syndromes are radial tunnel syndrome and posterior interosseous nerve syndrome. Posterior interosseous nerve syndrome, main clinical presentation, pain and weakness of wrist and fingers. No sensory deficit. MRI is sometimes useful to diagnose posterior interosseous nerve syndrome. Treatment is surgical decompression. Radial tunnel syndrome presents as resistant tennis elbow. Entrapment of radial nerves may be: one, at the fibrous band to the radial humeral capsule. Number two, at the fibrous medial edge along the extensor carpi radialis brevis. Number three, by the recurrent leash of vessels over the nerve. Or number four, at the fibrous arcade of Frosch, which is formed by the proximal superficial edge of the supinator muscle. Diagnostic test is local anesthetic injection for pain relief 5 cm distal to the lateral epicondyle. Clinical examination: increased pain by resisted active supination and passive forced pronation of the forearm. Middle finger extension test may produce pain as extensor carpi radialis brevis is inserted into the third metacarpal. Treatment here is decompression.